Welcome back to Let's Play Cyberpunk 2077 Blind. I'm Amethyst Lunatari. Heading toward our last cyber psycho. I'm gonna hang a Yui here. So I'm curious to see what this last one's going to be like. And I'm also curious to know what happens after I take care of them all. Do I get a little, another little prize for that? Or does this Regina just tell me things? I was going to get out for that. No, never mind.
Who would have thought?
We would have thought what? Oh. Dead scout. Dead maelstromer. Unresponsive, no pulse. Cause of death, shock and blood loss due to multiple lacerations. And if that didn't get him, would have been the fire. They always spook me for some reason. I never know what's gonna happen. Well, he's from the Valentinos. He's not the Cyber Psycho, is he? Ninjutsu went up. Same. Multiple lacerations. Farewell. Tamara, I've been trying to reach you ever since they took me. I know you're looking, and I know you'll find me. You mean I got it? That was him? Well, he was the easiest one of all. I'm already got to message her. I've been trying to reach you ever since they took me. I know you're looking, and I know you'll find me eventually, but I don't know how to make it any easier. Don't think I can on the net. I should have listened when you taught me how, but now I screwed myself. Honestly, I don't even think you'll recognize me if you saw me. I know I don't. Should just stick a barrel down my throat and be done with it. I'm such a monster. Screw me. Gang ain't taking me back. Not without a bag over my head. I got these, like, tractor hands and ugly as sin red eyes. All I can think of now is your chums who poison you to me, telling you not to get with a Valentino, that he'll leave you for someone else, vanish without a word. I'm gone, and they'll beat their chests all justified and tell you, told you so, but couldn't be more wrong. It's driving me loco. I feel like my head's gonna explode in a million pieces. I can feel the pressure building and building and building, but I don't know when it's gonna pop. So what's his name? Lely Hine. What's that? Oh. Can't be it. message her before I do anything else. Dino has something for me. Lack of empathy. Surprise! Check the nearest drop point. Got something big waiting with your name on it. Consider a gentle nudge to make sure you keep taking these jobs in the same preem direction. Yeah, I think I've already got that. Regina. Okay. I'm not seeing any other gang activity around the bridge, so we can safely rule out any score settling. Seems to me one of the maelstromers just had a bad day or dialed his implants a little too high. Hard to tell when it comes to them. All I know is the rest showed up at the wrong time and a bloodbath ensued. I'm betting on cyberpsychosis. Even Maelstrom's harshest welcomes don't come close to this. Our kid was a Valentino, not a maelstromer. Borg fiends must have had an axe to grind with him, because they stuffed him with implants like a Christmas turkey and just watched and waited for him to blow. Same would happen to anyone shipped that fast. Body didn't have time to adjust to the wear and turned him psycho. Good thing he still had a little self-control left, meant I could take him down quietly. Yeah, all I needed was two short circuits and a sonic whatever, sonic shock. So much easier than the last one, my god. Looks like our guy didn't even have to piss them off. A while ago, Maelstrom put out word it was looking for volunteers to test some new wear. Obviously, nobody stepped up, so the Borg guys just started scooping peeps up off the street. Valentino's been looking for this kid for a while. Not to mention the runner who swarmed the net with data feelers trying to track him down. Eventually, he must have broken free and fought for his life, made the Maelstromers reap what they sowed. Whole thing backfired on them spectacularly. Good thing you managed to get him to go down softly. Kid's still young. Maybe with the right kind of help he can learn to adapt to his new condition. Maybe. So I'm waiting to see if Regina says anything. Job complete. Job updated for Psycho Killer. Wait for update from Regina about the Cyber Psycho sighting. Sorry about that, guys. Alright. How long do we wait? I guess I'll leave him. Oh, what's in here? Huh. Let's look over here first. Oh no, a road closure. The end is near. What is back there? Like a whole separate area back there. I guess you could have run back here and ran away from him and stuff. He's not tough. Oh. Archive conversation with Vinny, Ray, and Herb Payne. And 82 euros here. Vinny Ray says, we loaded up Rudolph with the chrome today. It had him spinning hard for a while, but now he's sleeping like a baby. Herb Payne says, man, can you imagine the faces on those Tinos when we roll him over to them like a Trojan cyber horse? And he says, dude, so Novart, I'd want to feed from his optics to see them slice open those meat bags live. Oh my god. Herb says, by the way, sending the latest equipment. Let me know how our Trojan's doing, because I want to install it myself. And he says, I installed some Prime Red Karoshis on him. Not going to lie, he kind of looks like one of us now. Almost don't want to give him back. Mm, wonderful. Yeah, he killed you all. You guys are horrible. Hmm. And this is where we... This is where we came out. Three of them in there. Alright, I guess to go back, we gotta get one back through. Over stuff in here? I guess over the box. Pfft. Yeah. I'm real coordinated, like. Explosive server. What does it look like when you explode a server? I simply have to know. Not that impressive. I thought the thing was gonna go. Okay, now what? Should I wait? Oh, I'm not good. Oh. You know, I didn't know we had to change the radio like that. I don't normally do this, but we want to see how this ends, right? Thing is, I do it so infrequently that I don't remember what key it is. Skip time here. Oh, that's cool.
What's shaking, Night City?
Your man Stan here.
Never saw that.
Don't know if you've heard, but word is there's a mind-blowing, industry-changing BD in the works. Get this. The Crucifixion of Jesus Christ. Word's even gotten out about their pick for the lead role. A convict on death row with an expiration date. Should this dead man walking be able to swap the chair for the cross? Let us know what you think. Call in now.
Really? See if Regina has anything to say.
Night City! Josh Kevorkian here. And as always, your business is my business. Anyone out there still playing on the shares in the NCPD? If so, I recommend getting a doctor who woke you up from that coma to call your broker ASAP. Abandon share, sell.
The Night City Police Force is reeling from yet another day in the red. Since January, the NCPD's capitalization has slumped by a whopping 17%. And just after the force seemed poised for a meteoric rise, following its privatization in 2076, they announced an ambitious recovery proposal. A drones for cops replacement plan, a $5 per minute 911 hotline, a closer partnership with privatized prisons. But by the year's end, the gaping hole in their budget didn't shrink an inch. The mayor's office has a new proposal on the table for this lingering police problem. In the new solutions corner stand lobbyists from the corporate security industry. And you know what, folks? I say it's about damn time. You can't teach an old dog new tricks. The NCPD is a relic, a fossil. They're too blind to see that it's profit that drives success. If you want to be safe, and I mean truly safe, invest in the Ofuda Protection Plan from Arasaka. Take advantage of a today-only promo price of 100,000 euro dollars to keep you secure for an entire year. Spend wiser, never a miser, my friend. That's it today for your business is my business. Until next time.
Till next time. Alright, I see enemies.
Shit!
Oh, my relic. Maybe I should wait a minute. Hate that. There's two down.
Where'd you go, Blat?
They call me Biatch.
I'm no way. Oh.
Hold up there. Getting a beat on me over here. I'm scared, I just don't like being hit by bullets.
Не надо! Я не хочу!
Pathetic.
Чё?
Oh. It's like, oh. Elisabetta. Alright, everybody? I don't want anyone to be left out, you know? And you. And you. There's more stuff. There's something right there. Oh wait. Probably looking at that? Or that. And then there's something all the way down here somewhere? Oh, there's more enemies. Okay. That other area wasn't hostile. All right. So now we can finish reading our entries. So this will be the rest of the episode, if you guys want to tune out here. I mean, actually, let me get out of here. Because I was thinking maybe being in the car was interrupting with Regina's thing. Just pretend I'm sitting here. It's comfortable enough. I just want to go, actually, go to Noon. Let's see if she messages us. Hello.
Hey, V. Haven't heard of any cyber psycho attacks lately. I think it's time we put an end to our little arrangement.
Okay.
Drop on by sometime. We'll catch up in person.
Okay. Updated psycho killer. Alright, so I guess we're doing that at some point. Because it's not completed. Meet with Regina. Okay. We'll do that. Oh yeah, I guess next episode. How far away is she? Nah, not that far. Anyway, right now... Eh, it's a little over a kilometer. Let's finish... the database. We'll be completely caught up with the database. I'm just going to read the rest of these vehicles. Going to take a little bit. Around 25 minutes, probably more than 10 minutes, but what are you going to do? Delamain, number 21. A standard Villefort Cortez outfitted with an artificial intelligence, while other AIs on the market are little more than glorified chatbots connected to speech synthesizers, Delamain clearly possesses a well-defined personality. He can also bypass rush hour traffic jams like it's no one's business. Of course, Delamain is not so advanced to be self-aware, at least not according to his technical specs. He is self-aware. I believe it. Villafort Columbus V340F Freight, 2068. Rhymes. It's impossible to imagine the streets of Night City without the Columbus. This minivan is the cheapest and most recent model to roll off Villafort assembly lines. Many low to mid-tier shipping services use it for their deliveries. The Columbus is simple, functional, and its modest engine sure as hell won't get your heart racing, but you can bet on it to get the job done. Archer Hella ECD I-360, 2023. Cars should be made well, but never too well. Archer's board of directors learned this truth the hard way when, in 2023, they launched the first Hella series, which proved so reliable and easy to repair that it nearly drove the company to bankruptcy. It's going to happen next year, guys. Many who bought a Hella in those days for generously affordable price, it's worth noting, often never found themselves on the car market again. Even today, more than 50 years later, Archer Hellas are a fairly common sight on the streets of Night City. Of course, time has taken its toll, leaving many of them rusted and screechy. Still, they continue to move people from A to B, that is, unless they crash into something along the way. In those cases, there isn't much left to rescue from the wreckage. Despite their functional reliability, the car body is manufactured from cheap, brittle materials. Fortunately for most car owners, if you lose a bumper and a leg in an accident, both are easily replaceable. Imagine. Archer Hella ECH I-860, assuming that's an I, NCPD Enforcer. The base model of the Archer Hella has a number of positive attributes, but durability doesn't count among them. For this reason, NCPD commissioned Archer for a variant of the Hella model called Enforcer, which comes equipped with a reinforced body. Cheap plastic composites and glass were replaced with flame-resistant bulletproof materials, and flimsy bumpers were replaced with hardened steel bars. Ever since these armored Archers entered active service, many NCPD officers have found creative ways to use them. For example, to silence inconvenient witnesses or obnoxious criminals, some officers fasten in, hit the pedal, and slam into concrete walls. The vehicle emerges largely unscathed with the cops in good health, except for the occasional mild concussion, but the people in the back seat, well, they learn a valuable lesson before ever reaching the station. Well, they kill them? You can't teach a lesson to someone by killing them. They're not conscious to receive the lesson. Archer Quartz ECL R275 2041. After Archer released the Hella, the company ran into trouble. The popular family car proved so reliable and affordable that it quickly saturated the market. To avoid self-cannibalization, Archer was forced to diversify its portfolio by expanding into the sports car sector. The fruit of their efforts finally emerged in 2041 with the Quartz. This two-seater with a durable engine was marked at an approachable price, but the subtle elegance and sturdiness of its design made it popular among more than just the urban middle class. The Quartz is, as it turns out, well suited to endure the harsh desert climate. As a result, it has become a mainstay vehicle for a large portion of the nomad population. Any city folk who have dared risk interstate ground transport can likely testify that the silhouette of a Quartz on the horizon spells fast approaching trouble. Archer Quartz Sidewinder. The Aldecaldos, Meta, Jodes, even the Raff and Shiv, just about any nomad you'll find roaming North America would vouch for the Quartz's reliability and surprisingly solid performance in desert conditions. Unlike the vehicle itself, nomads tossed the corporate branding to the side and instead referred to this Archer model as Sidewinder. Of course, the name isn't the only piece the wasteland dwellers have chosen to modify, with swapped wheels, bumpers, and a performance-boosted engine. Sidewinders adeptly navigate off-road terrain and don't go down easy. So they have people like adapting these and making like unofficial versions of these cars. Porsche 911 2 930 Turbo 1977. Really? An all-time classic and king among 1% wannabes, the Porsche Turbo 911 2 930 is one of the most iconic cars in automotive history. Not many are left in the world, but the ones that remain are each worth their weight in gold. Its sleek, compact appearance is unmistakable. Who wouldn't want one? Sadly, none could ever hope to look as cool behind the wheel as Johnny Silverhand. Villafort Alvarado V4F570 Delegate, 2044. You don't ride in a Villafort Alvarado, you cruise in one. This boat of a car, boasts an engine worthy of the street's respect. Despite its huge dimensions, however, the Alvarado handles well due to the double axles in front. Unfortunately, this innovative design is still fairly unreliable and requires frequent, sometimes expensive, maintenance. For many in Night City's underworld, the Alvarado serves as the ideal display of flashy luxury. The wide, sin leather upholstered seats also make cruising the city streets all the more enjoyable. Maki Gai Mai P126. Oh, that tiny thing. The perfect car for anyone on a tight budget. It's the cheapest mass-produced car available in Night City. All design decisions were made with one goal in mind: cut costs. Size, as small as possible while still fitting two slender people, and at most one shopping bag. Engine, probably stolen from a lawnmower. Materials, plastic as durable as a disposable fork. Safety test ratings, scraping by to keep street legal status. All tied together into an easily affordable package, and they say corporations don't look out for consumers' best interests anymore. They don't. Chevrolet Emperor 720 NCPD Iron Clan, 2073. In a city where there's as much bullet spray as ocean spray, the sight of a speeding police cruiser with sirens blaring is hardly enough to make any Night City resident bat an eye. But when an Iron Clan rolls down the street, suddenly shopkeepers shutter their windows and pedestrians duck behind dumpsters. The NCPD only deploys these monsters when the situations turn really hot. This variant of the Chevrolet Emperor comes standard with heavily armored bodywork, integrated Militech combat tech, and reinforced bumpers that crush other cars like Nikola cans. There's the love. Chevrolet Thrax 388 Jefferson, 2062. The automobile of choice among the mid-ranking managerial class, the Chevrolet Thrax is elegant, commands respect, and most importantly, it's safe. It's covered top to bottom in armor that allows it to cruise through mine explosions, while its bulletproof windows detect high-caliber bullets. Downsides? Despite a mighty engine with the capacity to reach dizzying speeds, the Thrax accelerates slowly due to its incredible weight. But better to reach your destination late than never, not to mention in one piece. Mahir Supran FS3. Everyone wants a Rayfield or a Herrera, but not everyone can afford it. It's with these customers in mind, the ones with big needs and limited means, that the Mahir Supran FS3 was built. Its biggest selling point? If you hadn't guessed from its look, sound, or feel, it's cheap as borscht. The Mahir Supran was constructed from cheap plastic, textiles, and wishful thinking. It breaks down often, but on the flip side, it's easy to fix. Its large size suggests it can carry a heavy load, but it's better not to get too carried away. The anemic engine under its hood might just give up on you. Herrera Outlaw GTS. A lot has changed in the last century, but Spain's reputation for automotive excellence has not. Case in point, the Herrera Outlaw. This luxury limousine is one of the most exclusive and sought after on the market. It seamlessly combines the latest tech with a classic, sophisticated design. The Outlaw is a car with soul, perhaps because it's one of the few models out there still handcrafted with the expertise of world-class engineers. Of course, that kind of exclusivity and quality doesn't come cheap. Herrera's Outlaw is one of the most expensive street legal cars on the market. Rayfield Arendite Guinevere. For many, the name Rayfield is synonymous with wealth, and for good reason. The price of the Rayfield Arendite exceeds the GDP of many island nations, and it's worth noting this British-made ultra-luxury, ultra-performance masterpiece is worth every penny of it. The pedigree engine under its hood puts this car on equal footing with professional racing vehicles, and the interior feels like a five-star penthouse suite. But if that's not enough to get you excited, the Arendite doesn't have a single window. With the help of Crystal Dome, the vehicle's surroundings are displayed in real time inside the cabin, ensuring complete driver privacy and a stunning experience. Rayfield Caliburn. The rich can be capricious. The dignified design of Rayfield's flagship vehicle, the Arendite, doesn't appeal to everyone. Some prefer an equal level of luxury, but with a feistier flair. Rayfield developed the Caliburn with those clients in mind, imbued with a sportier soul and crafted with fire-breathing engine and aerodynamic body. Driving the Caliburn feels like flying a jet at ground level. And wherever the driver wants to come down from their whenever the driver wants to come down from their adrenaline high, they need only let go of the steering wheel and let the onboard navigational computer take control. Okay. Kaukaz Bratsk U4020. Oh, wow. The Soviets may not produce world-class supercars, luxury sedans, or cozy family cars, but their military-grade vehicles are second to none. Anyone who has had the pleasure of sitting behind the wheel of a Kaukaz Bratsk can attest. This behemoth of Soviet engineering wields a gargantuan engine, but despite its enormous size, can be piloted smoothly in damn near any conditions with a tank in tow. The disadvantages? It can't fit on city roads, and it smokes like a tire fire. Militech Behemoth. The behemoth is so massive, it should have its own zip code. Okay, I wouldn't give it that much. Use it to transport a platoon or a tank without worrying about the occasional shelling. The entire vehicle is covered with a layer of armor 1.5 inches thick, and the windshield can withstand continuous fire from heavy machine guns. If you're still not convinced, its all-wheel drive system and beefy engine allows the behemoth to navigate in even the most difficult conditions. Interested now? Well, not so fast. The behemoth is not available to the public. Only government bodies and licensed corporations have the privilege of purchasing this military-grade wonder. Oh, poo, then. Kaukaz Zeya U420. The Kaukaz Zeya is the true hero of socialist labor. With a robust engine, a load capacity of 3 tons, and a surprisingly light price tag, this truck is sought the world over. During long freight trips behind the wheel of the Zeya, you may begin to ponder the optimal distribution of goods in a centrally planned economy. Long live the party! Yaiba Kasunagi CT3X. This is the fastest and surprisingly the most expensive motorcycle, originally built in collaboration with the Arisaka Corporation. Its sleek aerodynamic frame conceals a wickedly powerful engine. Ideally, anyone riding one should be chipped with reflex boosters to avoid flying into a traffic light at 100 miles per hour when making a sharp turn. The Kasunagi is a favorite among gangers, especially the Tiger Claws. How many more? Bunch. Nazari. The roar of one of these beauties gives all those corpos stuck in their sluggish, armor-heavy limos something to mull over in traffic. What if, instead of those endless quarterly report meetings or, barf, corporate responsibility retreats, they just hopped on one of those bad boys, got the motor running, and drove off into the sunset? Sigh, because the Arch Nazari isn't just a bike, it's a way of life. Brennan Apollo. The Brennan Apollo doesn't have the most elegant design, nor does it have the sleekiest metal finish or the schmanciest dashboard gauges, spelled wrong. But who cares? Only stuck-up city folk care about that sort of frippery, and the Apollo wasn't made for them. It was made for the desert. Its oversized fuel tank allows it to complete long distances without refueling, while its solid build and suspension can easily withstand bumpy and rocky terrain, not to mention a powerful engine that will outrun any Raffin Shiv convoy. Beast. Imagine a standard Thornton Mackinac, solid, stable. Now imagine it was tuned into the Devil's Auto Shop in the bowels of hell. You have the beast. This car is faster than the base model and comes equipped with racing suspension and a roaring engine that puts the factory version to shame. The jet black paint job could make a nun faint in fear. Really. Quadra Type 66 Avenger. The standard Quadra Type 66 is a powerful car on its own right, but the Avenger? Now that's another animal. The roar of its engine causes windows and the knees of car jocks everywhere to shake. Compared to its base model, the Avenger has better handling and top-end speed. Hell, it even looks better. Quadra Type 66 Cthulhu. The Quadra Type 66 was built to race, and when you optimally tune it, add some extra juice, swap out the firmware for soft, that's when you unleash a real horror from your worst nightmare onto the streets. Quadra Type 66 Javelina. Although the Quadra Type 66 was designed with city streets in mind, you can still find them out cruising the desert wastes. These modified models, called Javelinas, are equipped with light armor plating and expertly tuned engines, and thanks to Crystal Dome technology, the driver can remain unseen while still maintaining a full, unobstructed view of the surroundings. Kaukaz 271 Aras. Okay, we'll like a lot to say about this one. Soviet cities may be bleak, dangerous, and none too pleasant to look at, but they are clean. The Communist Party nomenklatura waged a domestic war on garbage. Down with candy wrappers and broken bottles. We stand against cigarette butts in our streets. Such were the rallying cries that were met with thunderous applause by party apparatchiks? I don't know. I don't know that word. These appeals, however, were not met with the same enthusiasm and dedication by miners, factory laborers, and kolkhoz farmers. As a result, the responsibility for widespread waste collection fell to the USSR's experts in robotics, paving the way to the birth of the Kaukaz 271 Aras. The Aras is an autonomous cleaning drone that quickly came to be known for its affordability and reliability, even if a bit clunky. To the surprise of the Soviet leadership and the General Secretary of the Communist Party, the Aras became a highly sought product for export internationally. It can now be found in major cities across the globe, including Night City. Many consider it definitive proof of the superiority of a centrally planned socialist economy. If you say so. Okay, getting there. Mahir MT-28 Coach. Oh, God. Some of these have more to say. In the past, approximately 4.5 million Americans worked as cab drivers, truckers, or bus drivers. Today, that number has fallen to less than 300,000. Of course, one major factor to this was the catastrophic drop in North America's population due to wars, epidemics, and climate disasters. Yet, even in the face of a population drop-off, driving as an occupation for freight and passenger transport was nearly made extinct with the advent of self-driving vehicles. Vehicles such as the autonomous Mahir MT-28 coach are now a common sight among major highways and interstates. For passengers, it has been a welcome change. Unlike human drivers, the Mahir MT-28 coach never needs to take bathroom breaks and is far less prone to causing traffic accidents. That said, autonomous vehicles bring their own set of risks. In 2068, on a non-stop route from Dallas to Tucson, a partial failure in the MT-28 coach's operating system caused the air conditioning unit and door locks to malfunction. The bus reached its destination, but all the passengers had been cooked to death in their seats. Oh my God. Of course, the board of Mahir doesn't believe the success and glowing reputation of the MT-28's primary function should be marred because of the occasional minor error in its secondary systems. Minor error. Here it is, the Militech Basilisk. Basilisk is a fitting name for this line of Militech armored vehicle. Much like the mythical monster that is its namesake, one look at the beast is enough to knock you on your back. As the characteristic silhouette of the Basilisk appears on the horizon, even the most formidable enemy forces will throw up their hands in unconditional surrender. An attempt at retreat is an exercise in futility. There is no escape from the Basilisk. This Panzer, despite its tremendous size, moves across desert terrain with incredible grace and speed, like a predator in pursuit of terrified prey. Then, with just one shot from its high-caliber cannon, it turns its prey into a steaming smear of blood on a hot slab of desert stone. That's awfully specific. Militech Griffin. With its reserves of active boots on the ground, Militech's leadership believed it was always burning money and resources on the same old problems. Soldiers had to be trained. They had to be equipped, fed, and paid. Then, after absorbing all that capital, one quick bullet to the head is enough to send the investment straight down the drain. As a result, Militech executives salivated at the prospect of using machines to replace a portion of their unreliable, soft human assets. Thus, the Griffin combat drone was born. Cheap, obedient, and durable, the Griffin never posed a risk of desertion or demanded a pay raise. And if one ever committed a war crime, Militech could blame it on a software bug caused by a sloppy third-party contractor. Managing an army had never been easier. Militech Manticore. Night City's police have complained to their superiors for decades that their lives are in constant danger. They fight criminals who are equipped with combat cyberware, high-caliber weapons, high-grade explosives, and military hardware traded on the black market. Each officer suits up for work every day, never knowing if there'll be the next badge-wearing fly splattered against the wall. The issue of officer safety is often revisited between NCPD leadership and city politicians. Every now and again, a plucky young aide to a city council member suggests that the city implement stricter gun control measures. Once the laughter in the room subsides, the meetings typically conclude with the city commissioning Militech for a new fleet of Manticores, their line of armored AVs designed for military operations. Everyone walks away pleased. The NCPD gets fancy new toys. The city council announces another public safety success. Militech pockets another billion-euro-dollar arms deal, and they all live happily ever after, until the next year. Militech Wyvern. In the second half of the 21st century, business is a battlefield, both figuratively and literally. Arbitration, lawsuits, settlements, these measures carry less weight in a world where corporate disputes are often fast-tracked to resolution through sabotage and assassination. For the prudent corporate employee, it's wise to arrive at any arranged business meeting in a suit made from reinforced polymers with a pistol tucked in the belt. Even then, most expect that the other side likely hasn't shown up empty-handed either. Such naivete is often enough to get you killed. For those business people seeking an edge in negotiations, Militech offers the Wyvern drone. When deactivated, it flits conveniently into a briefcase which can be concealed easily under a limo seat or in the corner of a conference room. When activated, it can turn a stubborn business partner into an obedient lapdog or a bloody heap on the floor. Either one. It's good to have options. Rayfield Excalibur. Rayfield is renowned the world over for its exclusive luxury limousines, the Caliburn and the Arendite. But even expensive cars can suffer from the same age-old problem as any other on the road. They can get caught in traffic. Sure, you could ask your security detail to empty a clip at the drivers ahead, subtly urging them to kindly get out of your way. However, most Rayfield owners prefer to avoid behavior as unrefined and inelegant as this. To avoid the burden of traffic altogether for its loyal consumers, Rayfield engineered the Excalibur, a luxury AV that allows you to arrive everywhere punctually, safely, and most importantly, in maximum comfort and style. That is, assuming your bank account is as close to bottomless as possible. ZetaTech Atlas. The Atlas is the flagship product of ZetaTech and probably the most popular AV model in Night City, used by both trauma team medic squads and N54 news teams. Its characteristic hum can be heard day and night in any district or neighborhood. When parents ask their toddlers what sound an Atlas makes, the little rugrats reply "woom woom" as they point up to the smoggy sky. What made the Atlas so we're supposed to ask what animals sound animals makes, but then again, they did kill all the birds in Night City. What made the Atlas so successful? The sleek design, attractive price tag, and dependable performance helped to be sure, but the most important factor was hiring Kieran Austerlitz as Zetatech's chief lobbyist. Already on a first-name basis with most of the city's bigwigs, Kira knows that its personal connections, not technical specs, that its personal connections, not technical specs, that sell AVs. Six left. Zetatech Bombus. And that thing. The Bombus was designed as a caretaker drone because, as most would agree, who honestly has the time to raise children? You're back in the office the day after you give birth. God, working 12, 13, 14 hours, and then another three stuck in traffic. Make dinner? Change a diaper? No chance in hell. Fortunately, the Bombus can fill the role of the dutiful parent, watching over the kids, playing hide-and-seek, and popping scop dogs in the microwave. And if your child catches a stray bullet through the window, no problem. The Bombus will even call for an ambulance. Unsurprisingly, with its simple and inexpensive design, the Bombus has found applications in other sectors as well. Courier services use them for deliveries, the NCBD uses them for reconnaissance, and gangs duct tape explosives to them to make remote-controlled bombs. Is there no problem a Bombus can't solve? Yes. Bring about world peace. End all war. Can't do that, can you? Zetatech Canopy. The Canopy is Zetatech's response to the Ares waste collection drone from the Soviet-owned Caucasus Corporation. Unlike the Ares, the Canopy was designed with the American market in mind, making it better suited to local demands. For example, its sensors and collection measures are better equipped to handle upwards of 1,000 XXX... How many X's? XXXXXL size soda cups when compared to the Ares. A long time ago, parents used to tell their unruly children to behave and focus on their schoolwork, or they would end up sweeping the streets for a living. Well, with the Canopy hard at work, now even that safety net is long gone. Four left. Zetatech Octant. Until recently, most considered Zetatech a second-rate company, hiding in the shadow of giants like Arasaka and Militech, but today those same people will now admit Zetatech has proven its mettle in manufacturing products that match the quality of their megacorp rivals and are even sold at a lower price. Take, for example, the Octant. Sure, maybe it lacks the elegant characteristic of Arasaka, maybe its composite materials aren't as high-grade as Militech's, but when it comes down to sheer firepower, the Octant is second to none. This drone series has quickly emerged as a favorite for dictators around the world who aim to pacify mass protests and wipe resistance cells off the map. When Zetatech sold its 1,000th Octant, champagne bottles were popped throughout the company's corporate offices. They achieved a sales milestone they could truly be proud of. Zetatech Surveyor. From the day the first flying car was made, experts were already making their predictions about the first flying bus and who would produce it. In the end, it was Zetatech who won the flying bus race when they released a Surveyor. This behemoth of the heavens is capable of delivering a platoon of troops behind enemy lines swiftly and intently. And although it was engineered primarily with personnel transportation in mind, the Surveyor is fitted with smart missile defense systems powerful enough to dependably fend off enemy attacks. Initially designed and sold for military applications, this colossal AAV is now frequently used for civilian purposes in many large cities, including Night City. So when a sunny day quickly turns to night, just look up. It won't be a solar eclipse, but a Zetatech Surveyor. Maybe. Or maybe something else. Second to last, Zetatech Valgus. Produced early in the 21st century, the Valgus was Zetatech's first combat drone. At the time, the company was still small and largely unknown, but in retrospect, the achievement of the Valgus served as a litmus test for Zetatech's future successes and growth. Although slow and clunky, this machine proved to be trusted and reliable, even in hazardous weather conditions and climates. Whether in sweltering heat or biting frost, the Valgus patrolled the skies and eliminated suspicious targets without hesitation. Outdated by today's technological standards and outmatched by contemporary drones, the Valgus still serves dependably along the border of North California and South California. If its deadly precision against defenseless immigrants wasn't still flawless, it likely would have been long retired by now. And finally, Quadra Turbo R740. Here's funny, the weapons. It says new, but there's nothing there. Oh, no. Okay. At the beginning of the 21st century, American cities were flooded with Japanese sports cars. Reliable, fast, affordable. But the release of the Quadra Turbo R proved that the decline of the American automotive industry had been greatly exaggerated. The Turbo R instantly became a classic of its type, a dream on four wheels. It stole the hearts of car lovers everywhere with its powerful engine, responsive handling, and badass vibes. But there was a downside. The Turbo R rode like a wild stallion, ready to buck unskilled drivers right out of the saddle. Only a real car jock could untap its potential. Amateur adrenaline junkies typically wound up losing control, hurting both themselves and their shiny new Quadra. And that's that. Don't walk. Anyway, thanks so much for watching, guys. Stay tuned for the next episode where we meet with Regina, and I don't know what else we're going to get up to. Until then, thanks for watching, and always, seek adventure.